Any movie where someone jumps into a body of water to avoid an explosion has had me wondering how water affects forces such as sound. Mythbusters did a fun video on the reality of surviving an explosion by being underwater, and I was fascinated to learn that sound actually travels faster underwater than it does through the air. But have you ever wondered how the speed of light is affected by water? Are those fish seeing the brilliant rays of fire before the people on the beach are? Well, you don't need to facilitate an offshore explosion to find the answer to this question. In this video, we'll show how with just a few items, a ruler, a cup of water, and a laser pointer, and a little math, are all you need to calculate the speed of light in water. Along the way, we'll learn one reason why archery fishing is so challenging. Let's talk about how light interacts with water. It moves at one speed as it travels through the air, then once it hits the surface of the water, the light's path bends and it moves at another speed. Let's analyze this by considering another situation where two speeds contribute to a single trip. A lifeguard needs to run down the beach and swim across the water to reach a struggling swimmer as quickly as possible. There are various options for paths the lifeguard could take. So she could run all the way down the beach, then turn and swim directly out to the swimmer. She could get into the water as quickly as possible and then swim the rest of the way. If she swam as fast as she could run, then it would make sense for her to travel in the straight line from her starting point to the swimmer. What makes this problem interesting is that like most swimmers, even very strong swimmers, her speed while running is faster than her speed swimming. So logically, she could run further down the beach before getting into the water to save some time, but how much farther? Well, that would depend on how much faster she can run than swim. Running much faster would mean she could stay on the beach longer, but swimming almost as fast as she runs means she should jump in closer than if she was traveling in a straight line. Let's define some variables here to help us make sense of the situation. We'll call the distance from our lifeguard to the water A, and the distance from the swimmer to the shore B. Along the water line, the distance from the lifeguard to the swimmer C. If we call the missing location of how far down the shore the lifeguard should run X, then this distance here can be written C minus X. The hypotenuses of these right triangles represent the path the lifeguard would take. How is this situation going to help us learn something about the speed of light? Let's set up our light scenario. The materials we'll need include a laser pointer, a cup, some water, a transparent surface, and a ruler. It also helps if you have a way to fix the position of the laser pointer, but it's not necessary. Arrange the item so that the light from the laser is hitting the transparent surface near the close edge of the cup and the bottom of the cup near the far edge. We've now got a great system where we can see the path of the light, but how this will help us learn anything about its speed isn't intuitive yet. This is where calculus in the lifeguard scenario helps us out. For the lifeguard, the shortest path would be a straight line. But since our lifeguard's speed will not be consistent for the entire trip, it's not the distance we want to minimize, but the time, which is not always the route with the shortest distance. Let's build an equation for the time this trip would take. We can utilize the handy Pythagorean theorem to define the distance run on the beach as the square root of a squared plus x squared. We can divide that distance by the speed she runs on the beach, we'll call this speed s, to get the time this part of the trip will take her. Similarly, for the swimming portion of the trip, we can calculate the distance she'd swim, which is the square root of b squared plus quantity c minus x squared, and divide that by the speed she swims at. We can represent her swimming speed as a proportion of her running speed. For example, if she swam half as fast as she runs, then her swimming speed could be written as s divided by 2. Or if she swam twice as fast as she ran, can you imagine that, then her swimming speed could be written 2s. In general, we could write her swimming speed r times s, where r is the ratio of how her swimming speed compares to her running speed. Dividing the distance swam by this speed gets us her time spent swimming. Adding these two times together gives us a formula that would calculate the time for the entire trip based on the distance and speeds. Our goal for this problem was to minimize the time of the whole trip. Looking at this equation on a graph and using sliders to assign arbitrary values for our variables, we can see that there is some value of x that minimizes the time this trip should take. Finding the exact minimum value, though, calls for our handy friend, the derivative. Taking the derivative of this equation allows us to solve for extreme values on the curve by solving for x when the derivative, or the instantaneous rate of change, or the slope of our graph, is zero. Taking the derivative of this equation is not as hairy as it may look, since x is the only variable that's changing and the rest of our variables are just placeholders for unknown constants, but we could use technology to find the derivative as well. So our result for t prime of x, or the derivative function, is this equation here. Setting this equal to 0 and solving for x would give us the length of x we're looking for. One thing to notice about the solution is that it doesn't depend on the actual speeds. Our variable s can be factored out of the equation entirely, meaning that it has no effect on the solution. But the ratio of the speeds, r, still does. Looking back at our graphical model, the equation for time, we see that changing s didn't have any effect on the x value of the graph's minimum. And this will help us later. You can complete the exercise and let your lifeguard friends know you've pretty much given them the secret to saving lives. I did hear that some researchers did studies to see how close lifeguards naturally go to the optimal path, and lucky for the poor swimmers, they get pretty close even without training. But let's back up for a second. What did this have to do with calculating the speed of light in water? The path light takes when shown through the air, then through a cup of water, is remarkably similar to the diagram for our lifeguard problem. But unlike the lifeguard, light will always take the fastest path to get from any point A to B. That is a cool physics fact about light. It is as if the light rays already did the calculus to know where to go to get to specific points in the smallest amount of time. In our handy at-home experiment, you can carefully measure the distances A, B, C, and even X, since you know that the system set up in front of you is already optimized for time, since light always takes the fastest path. As we noticed earlier, S has no effect on this relationship. Only the ratio of the speeds matter. If one lifeguard runs at 15 miles an hour and swims at 5, their fastest path will be the same one as another lifeguard that runs at 9 miles an hour and swims at 3, or runs at 6 and swims at 2. So we can use the derivative equation we used to solve the lifeguard equation, but rather than solving for x, we plug in all of our knowns and solve for the one thing still a mystery, r, the ratio of how the speed of light in the water compares to the speed of light through the air. I tried to be as careful as I could while taking these empirical measurements on my simple system I built at home, and I got A equals 5.5 centimeters, B equals 12.4 centimeters, C equals 9.6 centimeters, and X equals 3.7 centimeters. As mentioned before, since I know that the nature of light is to always take the fastest path, I can plug these values into our previous equation. This happens to be an equation we can solve by hand to get the value of R, or we can use an online calculator to get the value of R. I get about 0.769, meaning that light travels around 3/4 as fast in the water as it does through the air. The true ratio is very close to 0.75. It's astounding to me how closely I can estimate the value using such simple supplies. No quantum tachometers needed here. You can try building the system yourself and see how closely you can estimate the speed of light in water, and let us know how you do in the comments. The ratio of 0.75 is pretty significant. If the speed of light in air was closer to the speed of light in water, with the ratio close to 1, then the path would be closer to a straight line, like we discussed in the lifeguard scenario. But the fact that there's such a meaningful discrepancy between the speeds means the path has a notable bend in it, which can have a serious impact on the way we view objects in water. For instance, in archery fishing, many beginning archers have trouble hitting fish because of the bending of light. If archers shoot where they see the fish, the arrow will go in this path, and the arrow will be too high. They have to account for this bending, which means shooting much lower than the fish. How much lower than the fish depends on the angle between the shooter and the fish, but 10 inches or 25 centimeters is pretty typical. Now, there has got to be a nice carnival game that tricks people with this fact. And if you can think of a good one, put it in the comments. We'll split the profits 50-50. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.